Good afternoon, students. I'll be discussing with you the last topic of the syllabus and the fifth unit, which is on application analysis. The other faculty, other colleagues, Professor Arundhati Madam, Gauri Madam, and Dr. Harish Kanchanar from Department of ISC, they have discussed the fourth unit, and in the fifth unit, Harish sir has discussed about the first two parts of the application analysis. So I'll be discussing with respect to the application analysis, the remaining topics, and I will be giving you the introduction to the class design. So these are the things that comes under the application interaction, application analysis. So basically, let me just give the link, as we used to give the link between the discussion and what is the basic structure of the syllabus. So we have been studying about the object-oriented development, which can be implemented in five different steps, namely the system conception, then analysis, which has two steps, application analysis and domain analysis and application analysis. Then we have the system design or the architectural design. Then we have the actual class design followed by the implementation. So we have discussed about these five steps in very brief, and then we have discussed about the modeling, the use of modeling in this object-oriented software development. So in that, we have three models: state model, interaction model, and class models. Where the state model will help us in modeling the dynamic structure, and the first one, that is the use case models, will help us in modeling the static structure. The class models will help in once again modeling the static structure, and interaction model, whenever the system is in dynamic state, that is it is running, so what happens, that we'll be able to do it using the interaction models. So we have studied these three models in first unit, second unit, and third unit. Then we have started with the object oriented development, where in the third unit we have discussed, in the beginning of the fourth unit, we have discussed about the concept of the analysis, the domain analysis we have discussed. So in this unit, we'll be discussing about the application analysis, where we'll try to design the classes and we'll try to add the operations. Then we'll directly go for the class design, the actual design of the classes, how it can be done. In brief, we'll be discussing as per the syllabus. Okay, let's begin our discussion. I'll just quickly go through what all the things the Hari sir has discussed, right? So in the application analysis, we have these steps: determining the boundaries of the system, actors, use cases, finding the initial and final events, and prepare the normal scenarios, right? Prepare the normal scenarios. Then we have add variations and exceptions to the scenarios, find the external events, designing the activity diagrams, organizing the actors and the use cases, and followed by that, designing the domain class model, right? So we are trying to design the domain class model, right, in the application analysis, and these steps have been discussed in detail. So I'll be just directly going through the next part. In the application analysis, we have three parts. One of them is the application interaction model, application class model, and application state model. Interaction model, we are trying to model the interactions that is happening within the application. So please try to recall the domain. It is the classes which come from the domain. I've been telling this many times, and in the application analysis, within the application. So we are trying to find out what all the features we have within the application using the application analysis, which can be done in three different, using the three different models or diagrams or the methods. One of them is the interaction model, right, which involves designing the use case diagrams and activity diagrams and so on. Then the application class model, where we take the domain classes which have identified, we also identify the user interfaces, whatever the boundaries we have defined in the application interaction model, we take them and we design the classes. We try to find out the controllers. That's very important. Controllers are something like, as the name itself indicates, these are the classes which will manage the other classes. Similarly, we check the models, whatever the classes we have identified, with respect to the interaction model. So that is what we do it in the application class model. So we'll try to specify the user interface. We have taken ATM as an example. boundary classes are identified. Controller, this is very important, which is needed in the part that I am discussing, that is application state model. So these are the active objects that manages the control within an application. So how the control of the application happens in a whenever our project or the software or the product or the system is running. So how the things are happening, who is controlling power, that is the application, the controller classes. Okay, so controller is an active object, it is an object of a class, and the class is meant to control whom, the working of the application. So for our ATM example, we have the outer loop verifies, like we try to, as a customer, we go to the ATM kiosk and how the user is entering the data and all, so that comes under the outer loop and which all the accounts they are accessing, and inner loop is with respect to the transactions that are being carried out, right? So with this, we have the controllers within the given ATM example, outer loop and the inner loop, right? So this again has to be checked with respect to the interaction model. Okay, then the last model that needs to be applied in the application analysis is the application state model. I'll be dealing this in detail. Okay, so application state model. Yes, one more thing, that in the syllabus you may find that we are going to the, after the application class model, going to the class design, but we felt that this is very important for CSE and IS students, both of them. So we have added the application state model and adding operation. These are just two some important topics, not in very detail, but they are important. So we'll be discussing application state model. Then we have the adding of the operations, how it is to be done. Then thirdly, I'll be giving the introduction to the class design. These three are important part of the fifth unit. So I'm just discussing. Then the application state model, it focuses on the application itself. So which all the application, the application classes, which augments the domain state model. Okay, so the steps in the model, the steps in this particular model are, so here we try to concentrate on the domain of the given application that we are trying to develop. Why? We are trying to model the states that are being attained by the objects of the classes identified in the domain state modeling or the domain analysis and in the application analysis. Okay, so the first thing that we'll do here is, we'll determine the application classes with the states, the classes with the states. See, this is basically what you learnt in the class modeling, the same thing is implemented over here. Okay, so nothing different. So we are trying to find out the classes with the states, we are trying to add some operations, we are going to build the classes, we are going to build the state diagrams. So these things we are trying to do it over here. So first of all, we are trying to determine the applications classes, application classes with the states, and then we are going to find out the events. So what are the events? The occurrences with respect to the time, we are trying to identify the events, and we try to give a connection between these two by the help of building the state diagram from the states that we have identified, then checking against, after building the state diagram, checking against other state diagrams which are been identified in the previous interactions, checking against the class model previously identified in the application class model, the second step of the application analysis, checking against the interaction models which have been identified previously. So this is basically whatever the classes have been identified, drawing the state diagram for that and checking them whether they are inconsistent with the previous diagrams, the models which have been drawn or not. That consistency needs to be checked. So in one by one, let's visit the first two steps, that is determining the application classes with the states. Okay, so we are going to identify what the application classes with the states, what are the tricks we need to follow for doing this. The first one is good candidates for the state models. We have to consider which all the candidates are the good candidates for designing the state models. These are the user interface classes which have been identified. For example, for the ATM example, we have this one. This is the user interface. So for this interface, we are going to consider as one of the class for which you have to find out the states. Why to find out the states? Because we want to visualize more and more features and the functionalities that are to be designed and added to the classes. More and more operations to be designed and added to the classes. Then we are going to consider the controller classes. Controller classes means outer loop and inner loop classes. Right? What do? They try to manage the control of the application. That is the controller classes. For the ATM example, whatever the controllers have the state, that will elaborate. In the sense what? I'll just show you that controller classes over here. So these are the controller classes, right? The outer loop verifies the customers and the inner loop verifies the service transactions. So these are the controller classes we can consider for identifying what the application classes with the state, and for these classes we are supposed to do the remaining things. What are the remaining things? Find the events. For example, study the scenario and extract the events. So how it can be done? How to find out the events that are happening? So you have to just check which all the scenarios that are there for doing the deposit of the money, withdrawal of the money, and so on. So this is one scenario. You all know the scenarios can be used to design a sequence diagram. So that way you can just go for designing the scenarios and extract the events from that, and from that you have to design a domain model which will find the states and then find the events. So that is the way to do it. And finally, what we are trying to do is, after the events have been designed, then we have to elaborate on the states. For example, if you consider the insertion of the card will involve the entering of the password, end session, and taking the card. This is a scenario that we are supposed to find out. How this scenario, what all the things are involved in the scenarios? The events are, insertion of the card is one event, entering the password is another event, and so on. These are the occurrences in time. So we have to find out the events by the help of the scenarios. That is what we are supposed to consider. And which scenarios? The scenarios of the what? Of the, you can just say, the user interface classes and the controller classes. The user interface classes and the controller classes. So for the ATM example, we have identified these as the classes. Okay, and this is a very important step. Whatever the state modeling you have studied, which will help us in identifying in more detail about the working or the states that are being attained by the object. So the same steps have been written in different way. So what we are going to do is, we are going to build the state diagram for every application class with the temporal behavior. This behavior is not a final behavior. It's not a final behavior. We are not going to design the class directly. We are not going to code directly. So it is a temporal behavior we are going to consider. We are going to find out which all the initial states are there. Generally, we do this in the state model. We will write the initial states, final states, right, intermediate states. So like that, we are going to write the initial states. We'll check, are there any loops in the sequences of the events that are going to happen? And similarly, we are going to consider, are we doing something like different sequences for the same task? So if that is the case, we are going to merge the sequence diagrams into the single state diagram. Different sequences of the events, we are going to convert that into the form of the state diagram. So it is basically how, till the domain analysis, we have modeled the things separately. Now we need to combine them into one. That is what we are trying to do it. Then we have, after the normal events have been considered, whatever the events that are there in the previous classes, we are going to add the variation and the exception classes. So these are the extra things that we are supposed to add it to our state diagram. Similarly, if there are any classes, identify the classes with the multiple states. If for a given state there are multiple classes that can be identified, if there is a class with a multiple state, so design them as a different state diagram and proceed. Similarly, we need to study the interaction scenarios to find the events for these classes, and finally we need to detect the overlap and closure of the loops. So that is, the repetition of the same scenario, same events may happen in a state diagram, we need to consider. So this is one example of the controller class. Which controller class? Transaction controller class. So in the transaction controller, so we are going to start somewhere over here, right? We are going to start by the concept of displaying the things in the ATM machine, and then that is the main screen. And from here, we are going to deposit the money, transfer the money, withdrawal of the money. These things will happen. Now you can see the outer circle over here. So the outer circle, we have these different operations being done. Suppose these operations are to be cancelled, we need to come back to the main screen and display the finish. This is a end state. So that is a main part of the state modeling. That is initial state, end state, and look at this. These things are not shown separately. In a single thing, it has been shown. It means that the same control should go back to the main screen. This is what we are going to do it in the state model. Okay. So we have this this sequence of events which have been designed for which class? That is the transaction controller. I told you, no, we need to consider, look at this, which of the classes we have to consider, the user interface classes or the controller classes. So here the transaction controller classes is considered. Okay, so it's available in the textbook as well, the same example. Then it is just like a manual task, like we need to just check after identifying the state diagram. The fourth step is check against the other state diagrams. If you have identified the other state diagrams which look like doing the same thing, then we need to check it, right? For example, in our ATM example, session controller is going to initiate the transaction controller. Look at that. We are trying to find out what? Check against the other state diagrams. Okay, what is the meaning of it? Is there any relation between one state diagram and another state diagram? Are they same, or one state diagram or one state is going to initiate the another state? So that is what we do it over here. Session controller is going to initiate the transaction controller. Similarly, the termination of the transaction controller causes what? The session controller to resume. Okay, so like this, we need to find out the relationship between the states. Check against the class model, right? Multiple ATMs can potentially concurrently access an account. Look at that. Multiple ATMs. So we may try to use the different methods of accessing the same account, so that we are supposed to check it. Account access needs to be controlled to ensure that only one update at a time is applied. So what is the meaning of this? Checking against the other classes means one class should not independently execute or work with other classes. And for what purpose? For the same task. So for the same task, one class should not repeatedly do the same thing. So what happens? There will be a problem in the transactions, concurrency, consistency, clarity, and finally the customer, in this case, the customer will be in trouble. So we need to check whether one state is trying to follow the other state, one state is trying to control the another state, one state comes after the another state, one class is independently working with respect to another class, or one class is going to initiate another classes, and so on. Like that, we are supposed to check, and the same thing is applied to all other interaction models. So what are the interaction models? The activity diagram and sequence diagrams, whatever that we have done. We need to check the state model against the scenarios of the interaction model. Whatever the scenarios we have identified previously, we need to check with respect to the interaction model and maintain a consistency in this. So finally, with this, the application state model can be implemented in 5 different steps, namely determining the application classes, finding the events and the scenarios, and here very importantly, we are going to consider the most of the times user interface classes and the controller classes, and then we are going to build the state diagram and check this state diagram that we have identified with respect to the other state diagrams, other classes and other interaction models. So these are the 5 of course 6 different steps that we can do it with respect to the application state modeling. So what do we have right now? We have the application classes, we have their state models, we have the interactions between the classes. So interaction models, class model and state model is there with us. But are we done? No, we are not done. We are still have some work to do. What is that work? Adding the operations. As all of you know, adding operation means in object oriented terms, I have a class, and in the class I have the set of data members or the attributes and the behaviors being implemented as the operations. Okay, so these operations, when to add these operations in object oriented programming, let me tell you, designing the operations or investing more time on the operations in the initial stages is not suggested. Why? I will tell you, you may say that I have a pen class. I have a pen class. What all the features you are going to add to this pen class? You may say that, okay, start writing, stop writing, close, rest, and so on. But it doesn't stop here, because there are some pens which can do n number of tasks, like a spy pen. It can do many things. So there is no end for this. So the statement, please concentrate on the first statement. We should add major operations now, but to some extent. To what extent? There is no extent for this. So remember, in any object-oriented software development paradigm, you need to add the operations. And I have been keeping telling you about this, that you have to add the operations, but to what level? You are supposed to add to certain level. There is no clear-cut guidelines for it. So it is an open-ended problem. What is that open-ended problem? To what extent I should add the operations? You should add the operations which come in mind or as the outcome of the discussion, first thing. Second thing, you should add the features for the operations. You should add the features for the operations which are very important. For example, when I want to withdraw the money, checking for the balance is an important feature. I need to do it. When I enter the password, ATM pin, then that needs to be checked with respect to the correctness. That is an important feature. So add it now. So whatever the remaining things are there, you can add it, because in the object-oriented, you have a hierarchical structure being arranged, and that hierarchical structure will help you to do the future updations, right? So you need not have to worry about adding some extra operations which are not important but needed later stages. But right now, you are supposed to add the important feature. So how to add it? There are just two guidelines given for it. The first one is operations from the class model. So we have to consider whatever the class models we have designed. From that, we are supposed to find out the attributes and the relationships. So whatever the attributes that are there, for example, for a customer class of an ATM, what are the attributes? Name, the account number, and the other details. So what all the things the customer can do will come out as a part of the attribute. One of them, balance will be one of the attributes. Using the balance, you can do the deposit, withdrawal, transfer, and so on. That's the way to identify the operation. And you need not show them explicitly. You need not show them explicitly, right? You can just show as a part of the statements. The second important thing, let me just correct. There are three steps using which we can add the operation. One more is there. I'll discuss it. So the second step is operations from the use cases. The moment you draw a use case diagram, you will come to know what all the operations will be there for the application and for which of the classes that can go. So the use cases will show you the activities, and many of the activities will correspond to some operations. For example, consortium of the bank, right? So whenever you want to use the ATM of different banks, then that bank should be associated with the consortium. And the moment you enter the card, you need to be checked. Your card needs to be checked with respect to whether it is a valid card. And if yes, is it belonging to a bank which is registered to a consortium? So that makes it as one of the operations. Similarly, bank verify the password. A bank class should verify the password of the user who is going to enter. Similarly, ATM verify the cash card. So for an ATM card, you have to verify the cash card. These are the features. See, these are the operations that should go in some of the classes. Consortium class should be able to verify the bank code. Bank class should verify the password. ATM class should verify the cash card. Similarly, these are something like a outcome of the previous two, that is shopping list operations. The meaning of this is, the moment user comes and uses the application, so what all the operations we can identify from that, that comes as the part of adding the operations. So it is, what it is? A real world behavior of the classes suggests the operations. The moment a customer comes, goes and stands in front of the ATM machine, so what is that they are going to do it? So that comes under this particular part. So example for ATM, account.close. The moment the user finishes the work with his accounts, so that needs to be closed. Similarly, we have the different examples like bank.create savings account customer. That is, the user should be able to create a savings bank account, checking account, and cash card authentication and so on. Authorization, not authentication and authorization. So like this, this is another part of the application analysis, that you identify the classes, you identify the interaction models, you identify the state models, you build the classes, and then you add the operations. Which operations? The operations which are very important. Do not waste much time in adding all the operations of the class, because that needs to be done where? The complete class diagram should be ready in the class design, not in the analysis. Remember this. We are going to add only selected important features. And why? The reason is, the operation, the number of operations for a class is open-ended, right? So finally, after doing this, we have partially designed ATM domain class model, or the the outcome of the analysis. This is what we are going to have it. This will go as input to whom? To the system design. Okay? This will go as input to whom? To the system design, where the architecture of the system will be ready. Some architecture diagrams will be used. Block diagrams, tiered architecture. I used to ask in the labs, the SD labs, I used to ask this, that where is the architectural diagram, block diagram, how many tiers are there? These are the questions that I used to ask. Correct? So this will be given as an input. What are the things? The classes which have been identified, and the interaction models, or the interaction between the classes, and the state diagrams of the classes is designed in the analysis phase, which will be given as input to the system design, and followed by that, right? In the system design, these things will be just considered for designing the architecture, nothing more. So thinking that, what did we do was, we just went for the next topic, which is on the class design. Again, it's a very elaborative unit, so it becomes very elaborative. So what did we do? Instead of skipping, let's add a small part of it. Both IAS and CSE students, I request all of you to do these three topics very importantly. That is application state model, adding operation, and overview of the class design. We found that the class design is very, very important part of the software development, which is the fourth step, of the object-oriented design, and followed by that is the implementation. So just we added this introduction or the overview of the class design. Okay, so I'll be just discussing with respect to, I'll be just discussing some of the steps in detail, but in brief I will discuss with you most of the steps, some of the steps I am going to discuss with you. Okay, so let's go to the class design. So what is a class design? Analysis, you know it, phase, the analysis is for, it is going to determine what the implementation must do. In the design phase, will determine the plan, but the class design will identify the definitions of the classes and the associations in detail. It will identify the algorithms in detail. That's very important. Okay? So what exactly is a class design? It is an iterative process. It's not like one after the other. It is going to iterate. Whatever the classes we have identified in the previous steps, we are going to iterate on that, and at each level we are going to decide on new operations attributes. Look at that. There also in the state model we have identified the main operations. I was telling you main operations are identified, but now all small, big, whatever the other operations are there, which are the outcome of the system conception, analysis, system design or the architectural design, are going to be added over here. So we need to build the complete class now. No compromise on what the class will have. And finally, we are going to revise the relationships we have identified. So the class design will have these steps, namely bridging the gap from the high level requirements to the low level requirements, realize the use cases with the operations, formulate the algorithms, right? And we need to recurse downwards to near to the low, from low, higher level operations to the lower level operations, refactor the model, and similarly optimize the excess path optimization, refi the behavior, adjust the class structure to increase the inheritance, and organize the classes and associations. Okay, so I'll be just discussing the steps, few steps in brief. right? The first one is bridging the gap. Where is the gap? The gap is you have the desired feature from the customer identified in the initial stages, and you have the available resources. You need to build what? Something in between this. What is that something in between this? It is this. Something in between. That is the available resources. These are the desired features, and these are the intermediate classes or the intermediate elements. This is the main task of the class design, bridging the gap. So what are the resources you are going to have? Resources, it could be a human resource, or it could be the software program that you have designed, the artifacts that you have designed. These are the resources, features are the requirement from the user that you had written in the first step of the system conception, right? So this is what we are supposed to find out, and the domain expert and the person who has the expertise in the analysis and understanding of the software process, development process, they can do it very easily. Then we have to realize what? We have to realize the use cases which you have identified. So whether the use cases define the required behavior or not, right? So that we are supposed to do it over here. Then we have to identify the main purpose of the design. We need to write it, and responsibility, that is the object knows or something it must do. What is the meaning of this is, whatever the objects we have identified, the class, see, I've told you, a class comes by the group of the similar objects. So whatever the objects that we have identified, do they have a responsibility or not? We need to write it. So these are all theoretical tasks that we are supposed to do, right? We have to also identify the responsibilities, right? Whether it is properly defined or not is not a precise concept. So whether it is really given to an object or not, right? This is very important. You have done this in the fourth semester, that is the design and analysis of the algorithms. So we have to do this now here. So there are good number of steps given. Don't worry about it. You know it already. Just recall, the main part of the algorithmic design technique is to solve a problem using the software. You have the problem, you have to understand the problem first, then you have to ascertain the capabilities of the computational device, right? I hope you all are recalling. Then the next thing is, you have to find out the data structure that you are going to use it, right? And then you are trying to decide upon, you are supposed to decide upon the data structure, you are supposed to decide upon the algorithmic design technique. Followed by that is checking for the correctness, verification, analysis, and so on, right? So this is what you are going to do it. So you are supposed to decide upon the complexity of the given problem, understand the problem, design the solution for it, apply the algorithmic steps for it, right? And assign the operations to the appropriate classes. So you need to do these task with respect to designing an algorithm. So computational complexity can be identified by the help of the processor time, memory consumption, sorting, and type of the algorithm that we are going to use it. Depending on the type of the problem, we are supposed to go for designing the algorithm. And as all of you know, the main target of the analysis of the algorithm is what? Is the flexibility, is the performance with respect to time and the memory, right? Whatever, that's very important, because we are doing with the object-oriented programming. The main task of the object-oriented programming is extendability. The code that you write should be extendable. That's the main part of the object-oriented design, which should be reflected in the algorithms that we're going to use it. And the data structure that we use, you should use it in such a way that, depending on the type of the applications, it should be supportive for the algorithm. For example, I wanted a structure kind of a thing or a class, but I'm using an arrays or a single variable, that's not correct. So proper data structure should be used, right? And similarly, the operations that we are going to identify within the steps of the algorithm, that needs to be assigned to one or the other respective classes, right? So which are the classes? The controller classes and the internal classes, all these classes we are supposed to assign. So whenever we have multiple objects, this is an important part that you are supposed to know. Receiver of action. If there is an action to be done by an object, who is going to receive? Who is going to respond? This is what you are supposed to know, right? And difference between a query and an update. So a query should not update. It is a question, yes or no. Update means there is some changes to be done. So how this is being reflected in the algorithms, and followed by that, the focal classes, looking at the classes and the associations that are involved in the operation. So means consider any operation, any task. So how one or the other classes are involved and how one or other operations are involved, you are supposed to find out. Then the next task is recursing downward. The meaning of this is there are good number of steps given, don't worry. We need to arrange the things in the form of the layer, top layer to bottom layer, and in between some intermediate layers. This layering of the tasks and the arrangement of the classes will help in debugging the things in the later stages, right? So that's the best way, that is recursing. The design process works top to down. You start with the higher level operations and process to define the lower level operations. This is very important. What is that we are going to do? From higher level operations to the lower level operation. Take an example of the ATM. I want to withdraw the money. So what I will do, I will enter the card and all these validation will happen. But when I enter the amount, then what all the things should happen in the background? Lower level. Higher level, entering the amount. That is what we are supposed to design from high level to low level. We need to go to the low level now. We did not go to the low level in the previous steps of the object oriented development. We have to go to the low level. Okay. So we need to design a logical layer for the development, which will help us to go from high level functionalities to the low level operations, high level functionalities to the low level functionalities, high level layers to the low level layers, high level operations to the low level operations. This is what we are supposed to do, and refactor. So after you try to go from high level to low level, you will find that something is very important, something is not important, right? So keeping that in mind, we need to arrange the things, we need to arrange the structure. That is what the meaning of refactoring is. Recursing, refactoring. What is the meaning of it? A famous person, Martin Fowler, what he defines? The refactoring changes the internal structure of the software to improve its design. Simply, we are supposed to change the structure. Now here there is arrangement of the desk. This is being done in an ad hoc manner. Then I want to arrange this in proper way. That is restructuring, refactoring. Factoring, refactoring. Factoring, we have done it in the previous steps. We need to refactor. We thought that this is the best arrangement. We need to refactor it. Right. Similarly, the next important thing, which is the next important thing, is after the refactoring is the optimization. So till this point, I went in very detail. So the next task is the optimization. As in compiler design, we do the optimization. Here also, we need to optimize. Try to reduce the number of classes. Try to reduce the number of operations. One operation, you make it to do more things. So that is the kind of operations. Try to reduce the number of the amount of memory being consumed, right? Without losing the originality and correctness. The next step, that is the next step after the optimization, refine the behavior that must be manipulated. What is the meaning of it is redefine whatever the behavior that we were having, revise them. If it has refine the behavior that must be manipulated. Whatever the behavior we think that, okay, this behavior is not good in the optimization we found it. So just change them, improve them, and do some manipulation to improve the behavior. And then the other last two steps are inheritance. The classes should be designed in such a way, you know that inheritance is needed to extend. So for the extension of the code and reusability of the code, we go for the inheritance. We should never forget these principles, and we are supposed to arrange the classes. Classes we have already arranged. Remember, in the second step of the analysis, we have identified the classes and we are trying to identify the relationships. Okay. So this is what we have done it in the domain analysis. So there we have identified the relationships which may represent something like a weak inheritance, not properly designed inheritance. Try to adjust the class structure to increase the inheritance. For example, one account class can be having, suppose we have created three classes called as account class, savings account class, and a checking current account class. So instead of making three classes, make them as a single hierarchy as account class as a base class, and savings account and current account should go to the accounts class. That is the inheritance. And finally, this is the final thing, that is you have to organize the classes and the association. So now your class, I have been telling you, design a final class diagram. What does that mean for? The meaning of that is you are supposed to go for designing the class. You are supposed to go for designing a class. For example, look at this. If this is a class, you know the basic structure is the class name. This is the class name, and these are the operations. Sorry, these are the attributes. These are the attributes, and these are the operations. And like this, we have the class number C1, C2. We are supposed to design the class diagram, which will be full with what? With the class name, with the attributes, and with the operations, and everything being defined completely. Right? Here, the cardinality. Never forget it. The cardinality, multiplicity, cardinality, name of the association, right? Type of the relationship, everything should be complete, right? So organize the classes and the associations. So this is what we do it in the fourth step of the object oriented development, which we call it as the class design. Okay, which we call it as a class design. So I'll just brief out what did I discuss in the today's class. So I have started the discussion with respect to the state modeling. I have started the discussion with respect to the state modeling application, state modeling in the application analysis. I'll just quickly go through this. So I have just started with the discussion of this application state model, giving introduction to the previous topics on the application model. So there are three models: application interaction model, application interaction model, application class model. So I have discussed about the application state model. These are the five steps, that is determine the application classes with the states, find the events, build the state diagrams, check them against the state diagram, class check them against the class model, interaction model, and so on. So these are the steps involved in it, and this is an example of building a state diagram. And then I have discussed about the adding the operations, which has three parts of it. We are going to add only the main operations over here. Whatever the other least important and needed classes are there, we'll do it in the class design. So the first step is the operations from the class model. Second is operations from the use cases and shopping list operation. So we are going to build the final application state model, which will be given as the input to whom? It will be given as input to the system design and the class design. Okay, so after that I have discussed about the concept of analysis, where we are trying to define what implementation must be doing, and the plan will be deciding in the system design. And in the class design, we are going to complete the class diagram by adding the definitions of the classes, the associations, and which involves even writing the algorithms and completing the other operations, right? So it's an iterative process, and we are going to define all the operations like the attributes, behaviors, whatever the other things are there with respect to the other things means. Other things means what the class should do. All these things we are going to add it over here. Okay. So then these are the steps in the class design. So starting from bridging the gap, bridging the gap, realizing the use cases with the operations, formulate an algorithm for every operations, then recursing. So in bridging the gap, this is the gap we have to bridge this, available between the desired features and the available resources, right? Then we have to realize the use cases. Whatever the use cases we have identified, we have to realize them. We have to see whether every object and the classes have the responsibility or not. Then we have to go for designing the algorithm, right? The designing of the algorithm involves the process of finding the computational capability of the devices, the algorithmic technique we use, whether the algorithm is flexible or not, whether the algorithm technique consumes lots of memory resources or not, whether it is flexible or not. We are going to define that using the designing an algorithm. right? And then we have to go for recursing downward. That is, we have to follow a layered structure. When we say the class design, remember four things importantly. What is that? The first thing is algorithm, designing an algorithm. Second thing is recursing downwards. Third one is refactoring. Fourth one is refi the behavior. These are the four important, of course these are not the complete steps of the class design, but these are the four important tasks of the class design. So the first one is what? Bridging the gaps, finding out the responsibilities, but the major task goes in the algorithmic design. Then recursing downward, arrange them in the layers. Top layer represents the higher level responsibilities, bottom layer implement the low level responsibilities, right? And refactoring. So we have identified the classes and associations. We understood what is happening in the application. So we had to redesign the structure if needed in the refactoring. And followed by that, we have the other steps of the class design as optimization. Optimization is needed in order to reduce the redundancy and save the resources that are available. Then refi the behavior that must be manipulated. So we have to redefine the behavior which have to be manipulated. Then followed by that, we have the inheritance as a major part of the object-oriented development, right? The reusability of the code needs to be considered with respect to the design. So that needs to be done in the class design step. And followed by that, we have organizing the complete classes and the association. So as the output of the class design, you have the complete class diagram, which will be directly available for the development purpose or implementation purpose. Okay. So what does this mean? Let me name you some tools like Umbrello, the VPUML that you have used in the SD lab, or the Rational Row software. If you design the class, you can even design the diagrams, you can even design the classes, class diagrams and so on. You can directly convert these class diagrams to a code, which will save lots of coding time, right? So using the codes which you are supposed to write it in Java or C++, just you have to have a plugin installed onto that software. You can directly convert the class design into what? Into a working program. And then you need to add those operations which are written as I am using some algorithms in this, so that you are supposed to add it. Even these tools will help you. If you have code, it will convert them into a model also. So that is called as a reverse engineering concept being implemented in these tools. We can use it. Okay. So this is what we wanted to discuss with respect to the object-oriented modeling and design. Let me tell you, whatever the remaining portion from the third unit and the fourth unit, we have divided from like this. Arundhati madam has handled some part, and followed by that, the next part is handled by the Gauri madam, and then the next part, which is on application analysis, application interaction model and class model, is handled by the Harish sir from IAC department. But we have made our videos to be available here, and the last part of the fifth unit is handled by me, which is on the application state model, adding operations and overview of class design, which is important for both IAC and CSC students. And whatever the lectures that we are recording over here, we are making them available in the YouTube channels, right? So just go through them, read the contents that we have discussed here from the textbook. We have even shared the slides. I have shared all the slides from unit 1 to the last unit. So make use of it, study it, never stop the study or learning because of any kinds of situations. So stay in home and never lose learning, and try to submit whatever. Again, the OMD, I have told about the course project, so I have created a form for it. So try to upload your course projects. Another 1 or 2 days I'll be extending, so try to submit your course projects, course project reports. Okay, I have just shared the link for submission, so upload it. And whatever the queries you have, you can just discuss with us through different modes. Okay, so thank you all of you for patient listening and hearing, right? So stay home. stay safe and use whatever the guidelines given by the government. Thank you.